What we see here are the five different test-based thresholds that students need to pass in order to be reclassified, or to be eligible for reclassification. Now, there's a bunch of acronyms there. The first is the California Standards Test of English Language Arts. That's the one that we were looking at the outcome later for. This is a test that's given to all students, not just English learners. It's given to any student, a kid who's initially fluent English proficient, to kids who are fluent English proficient, to kids who aren't even language minority children. Every student takes this test. The other tests that are all labeled with CELT, that stands for the California English Language Development Test, those are all tests that are given specifically to English language learners. So we have two different policy periods here. We have the pre-2007 period and the post-2007 period. And there's no typos here. These labels are the same in each of the policy periods. However, I'm telling you that the CELT is not really the same. So it's the same nominal level, but what happened was in 2006-2007 academic year, the California Department of Education rescaled the CELT test to make it more difficult to attain the same nominal level. So they ratcheted up the criteria for the CELT. They did not change anything for the CST ELA, so that remains the same. The reason why they changed the CELT to make it more difficult is in part due to different teachers and administrators in California saying that students who are English learners who are getting reclassified are not able to succeed in mainstream English classrooms without additional supports. So they themselves were recognizing that the criteria might be too low for reclassifying English learners. And California, in response, said, let's examine this and then perhaps rescale the test. And they ultimately did rescale the test to make it more difficult. So now I told you that it's more difficult, but let me show you whether or not we see that it's more difficult. So this shows you right here the percent of English learners who attained the CELT or the CST thresholds. This is only for the kids in elementary school. I'll show you middle school and high school later. What we're looking at here is the percent of kids who passed the CST ELA. This is the test that did not change in each of six different academic years. And I put a little dashed line vertically between 2006 and 2007 because that's when the CELT changed. So, but the CST didn't change, and what we see there is that consistently, roughly about 50% of English learners are attaining the CST ELA, right? They didn't change that test. We don't expect anything to suddenly change between 2006 and 2007. Now, the CELT did change, and what we see there is that there is a drop in the percent of kids who are passing the CELT. In fact, it's about a 15 percentage point drop. That was in elementary school. In middle school, what we see is there's a 19 percentage point drop, and in high school, we see the largest drop, a 31 percentage point drop. So they tried to make the test harder by rescaling it, and they did do that. So now what we want to do is, now we see that they made the test harder, we want to see, did making the test harder and changing the criteria have an effect on subsequent outcomes, such as academic performance and graduation likelihood? So to study that, what we're going to do is we're going to limit all the analyses to include only students who pass the CELT criteria for their given time period. Now what that means is, in the earlier time period, the pre-2007 time period, this is going to include a lot of students who met a low threshold in the CELT. In the post-2007 period, those students aren't going to be in the analyses, right? Because there's a higher level of the CELT that needs to be attained. So now there's going to be students who have higher English language proficiency in the post-2007 period. Then what we're going to do is we're going to perform an analysis that's called a comparative regression discontinuity with instrumental variables, or a difference in regression discontinuities with instrumental variables. That's a lot to understand, so let me just explain to you a little bit of what the design is. I'm not going to show equations in this. If you're interested in the equations, you can go to the papers that I referenced earlier. So what this means is we're going to focus on the students who barely did and barely did not attain the final criterion, which is the California Standards Test of English Language Arts. This is what we refer to as a regression discontinuity because it compares the kids just below and just above the threshold. Then what we're going to do is we're going to account for differences in adherence to the policy. This is the instrumental variable component. I'll explain that a little bit. And then what we're going to do is we now have two different estimates, one for each policy period. So we're just simply going to subtract off the effect estimate that we get from one policy period from the other policy period. This is the comparative or differencing stage. There's also a matched comparison group where we have an inverse probability of treatment weight that we incorporate into the design. And I'm not going to present those results here to you, but the results are robust to any of these types of specification checks we try. We limit the analyses to Latino, Latina English learners in Los Angeles Unified School District between 2003 and 2010. This gives us a sample size of over 600,000 students. The results for grades 3 to 8 appear in the paper, but I'm going to talk about the results for high school right now. So, first thing we want to look at is whether or not policymakers have an effect on the likelihood of reclassification. What we see in this first panel is along the X dimension is the California Standards Test of English Language Arts prior to reclassification. So this is the final criterion that students need to pass. Now they've already passed 4 of the 5 criteria, and this is the 5th component. The students who were just below 0 did not pass the criteria, the final criterion. But the students who were at or above 0 did pass the criterion. So there's a 50 percentage point increase in the likelihood of reclassification associated with getting one extra point on this standardized test of English language arts. Now, just to convince you more that these students are virtually identical who are just below the threshold and just above the threshold, the California Standards Test of English Language Arts has a scale that goes from 150 points to 600 points. The students who are scoring 299 points are the ones who fall just short of reaching the final criterion, and they have virtually no chance of being reclassified. The students who get 300 points on this test, so that one extra point, have a 50-50 chance of getting reclassified. So this has dramatic consequences on students' likelihood of the teachers that they're going to be instructed by, the peers that they're going to be instructed alongside, and the academic content that they're instructed with. And sometimes even also the courses that they can take, that they're eligible to take. So with this design, what we're doing is we are comparing students who are virtually identical, but one gets that extra point and then has a greater likelihood of getting reclassified, and the other one fails to get that extra point and therefore isn't reclassified. So by isolating this particular component, we can see essentially as if this were a random chance of kids getting reclassified. Okay, so this is in the pre-2007 period. In the post-2007 period, what we see is that there's also an increase in the likelihood of reclassification associated with that one extra point, but here it's a 75 percentage point increase. So this tells us that there's two different likelihoods for reclassification in the two different policy periods, where there's more of a chance you're going to get reclassified in the later policy period. So our analyses are going to have to account for that, and that's what we're going to do when we pull in the instrumental variable analysis. Okay, so now we want to see what the effects of getting that extra point are on subsequent outcomes. So now the x-axis is the same as it was in the previous slide, in this slide, but the y-axis is different. Instead of looking at the likelihood of reclassification, we're looking at the next year's performance on a standardized test of English language arts. And what we can see is right at the threshold, because those are the only kids we can really compare with this particular design, the kids right at the threshold, we see that if you get an extra point and you have a higher likelihood of reclassification, you have lower performance on next year's achievement test. So the kids who are falling short of the likelihood of getting reclassified are the ones who are actually performing better. So this would suggest to us that the kids who are reclassified are performing worse, the kids who are not reclassified are performing better, and this is not really an optimal transition point, because if the students who remain English learners are performing better, then that suggests more students should remain English learners by this particular kind of design and logic. So then what we see is the California Department of Education made the criterion more difficult in the later period. And then we're going to see if, when they made the test more difficult, do we see that the effects go from negative to something either null or more positive. So we in fact do see that. So now we're looking at the post-2007 period. And again, if we're comparing kids just below and just above the threshold, here we see that they're performing nearly identically, right? So this would suggest that we're having a smooth transition point once they made the criteria more difficult to attain.